Presidio, Texas, which is a border crossing, they stopped somebody that had 748 pounds of Mexican bologna.
You just had a big dick.
40 rolls of meat were hidden in suitcases around the car.
The law-abiding citizens that can go through these background checks and get a gun legally will do this. They will go through the waiting and the paperwork and all that bullshit.
They won't like it, but they'll do it.
Right. But if you know you're not going to meet these standards, you just go down the street, go to a corner, whatever the case may be, as guns are easy to get. So it's like, I don't understand this part of it. I don't think this will fix anything myself. It's just, it's going to make law-abiding citizens go through more and more and more. So...
Welcome to Stay in the Gray Podcast. We explore news that gets people talking by blending comedy and controversy. Blue mana, fearless word, shadow street, streets Butthurt. Stay in the gray, echoes haunt, feel the pain. I'm Ryan.
And I'm Trey. Together we dive into tough topics with a combination of humor and some insight.
So join us as we navigate the gray areas of the world and engaging in real conversation.
Come get to know us.
Hey, Trey. Hey, everybody. Hey. I can't even control my excitement right now.
What the fuck was that?
Look, I can't even control my excitement. You know why, Trey?
Why is that?
Well, you know. I hope you know.
I do know.
Because tonight, ladies and gentlemen, is Stay in the Gray Podcast official... Special alternative presidential candidate debate.
What?
It is special alternative candidate debate tonight. Stay in the Gray Podcast is having an official debate between Trey and myself.
Holy shit.
Because the election is 2 weeks away.
Is it really?
Trey still claims he's undecided. I've made my inside clear, and I'm going to do my best to stay completely neutral. In fact, I may give myself like 3 interruption cards, and that's it.
Can I mute your mic at any point?
No. most people would probably want you to, but I promise I'll do my best to.
Will you? Behave.
Yes.
Okay.
And you know what, boys, our producers, if I get out of hand, you're welcome to mute me.
Half the show would be muted,
but
though.
Before we do our debate, because I think it's important, this is an important election. I don't even want to think about, and maybe next show we'll talk about it, what's going to happen after this election. Because either way, things are fucked. Like, people on either side are going to go insane.
Yeah.
We'll get there. But we want to make sure you have this in time to make an informed decision. We feel that Trey and myself can bring you that.
That's scary.
We're going to go with the 6 most popular topics for the presidential election. How do you feel about
this? If we sway anybody... I feel bad for America right now.
Trey, do not say that. If you listen and you go, you know what? I think I'm going to go a different way. I will do anything. We will give you a t-shirt, some pens.
Stickers.
Let us know that we helped you make a decision.
Yeah.
Because this would be, we'll bring you on the show. We'll give you all sorts of like props. We'll plug anything you want. Except.
But before we do that.
Things.
Before we do that,
we got to go through Stay in the Gray Podcast.
Yeah.
That means what, Trey?
My headline.
Your headline. Let's roll.
So I came across this. A 19-year-old TikToker gets in. When did TikToker
it's a verb.
Become a job?
It's a noun. Why is TikToker
a noun?
Yeah. What is a TikToker? Somebody that just goes on there or somebody that gets paid?
Probably gets paid, if I had to guess. An influencer, maybe.
I would do it.
So... He gets engaged to his 76-year-old billionaire girlfriend.
He's how old?
He's 19.
He's 19.
She's 76.
76.
A little bit of an age gap there.
Yeah.
He said it was love at first sight. Can you believe that? A billionaire, 76-year-old billionaire. Love at first sight.
I'm thinking that's not true. I'm thinking that her ass wasn't tight. I'm thinking that he didn't walk by and go, oh my God, look at those titties.
Yeah. She's able to pull those teeth out and do some fun things.
Right. Maybe that was it. But as soon as he saw the bank account, right?
He's ready to roll.
Right.
So he said he felt butterflies when he saw her. That's what Giuseppe Diana said about his new girlfriend, Malian Gata.
Well, sure.
She's got some pink hair, by the way.
Maybe it was the name that did it. Well,
hold on.
Okay.
Before you go any further.
All right. I'm just getting primed up for the debate.
It turns out that the pair have announced they're expecting a baby.
Oh. Nuh-uh.
76 years old.
I thought Gwen Stefani at 52 was amazing. But you're telling me a 76-year-old woman is having a 19-year-old's baby?
If you believe everything you see on the internet, then yes.
Man, that baby's going to be fucked. His mom's going to be in his life for like 10 years.
If that.
That's the only issue
I have. Well, she survived the childbirth?
That's the only issue I have with it, is you're bringing a kid in the world and you're going to leave him soon. I was upset at myself for being as old as I am.
But, I mean, he's a 19-year-old soon-to-be billionaire.
Well, that's true. Well, maybe that's what they thought of. He's in good shape. He can just hire nannies all the
time. Yeah. Why not?
Should he write a book on how to live life? Because this sounds pretty damn good.
It's interesting, right?
Isn't this what you said you always wanted? A wealthy woman?
A wealthy woman with one foot in the grave. Yeah.
It sounds like he took your...
And a bad hip. Yeah.
He took care of...
He took my game plan and ran with it.
He took it.
Damn it.
Well, that was good. I just... You know, the problem is when I hear stories like these, I think of their sex. And that's not healthy, because then you think of a 19-year-old that just needs to pound, and all of a sudden the 76. I mean, do you think they're active, like really active?
I mean, active enough to have a kid.
Yeah, but do you think she takes care of him, like you said, takes those dentures out?
I'm still surprised how she was able to get pregnant. I mean, is this a possibility?
I thought after menopause you weren't able to get pregnant, so I don't know if this is some sort of medical marvel.
Or maybe they got eggs from
True, but were they trying? You said it was an accident, right? Or did you not?
No, just that they're expecting.
I wonder if there's some sort of medical technology.
Interesting.
We might look it up, people.
I mean, she's a billionaire, so I guess you can figure something out.
That's crazy. That's good. Good headline.
Or she's got some strong sperm.
I like that one. Yeah. Those weak ass eggs.
Yeah.
The sperm's like, wake up.
I got you, bitch.
So my headline is not quite as detailed. My headline is simple, Trey. Man struck by lightning faces battery charge.
The fuck? See what you did there.
Yeah.
A little play on word.
Yeah. That's it. You don't need to know anymore. The man was struck by lightning, and he also apparently abused somebody and faces battery charge. What did you think it meant? Anyway, those are our headlines for tonight. I hope you enjoyed them as per usual. Let's go to a quick Butthurt comment before we move on, because I know everybody's anticipating this debate.
I'm scared of this debate.
Tonight, no, because there's no reason to be scared. I don't know shit. I act like I know shit, Trey. Can you tell I'm amped up? I'm amped up.
You are amped up. Very much so.
I love it.
You're keeping me awake.
It's just like before a big game, big football game, or before the debates that we've seen. You get excited. This asshole, was I not supposed to name call? This gentleman,
Weenie,
I'm assuming his name is Sean. Weenie's acceptable.
Weenie's okay.
This was a response to a video where, Kamala, I don't know if you knew this, but I'm going to say Kamala. I'm used to it. If it's Kamala, I apologize.
I've never heard the right pronunciation. Yeah,
people say it's Kamala, but I say Kamala. That's what I'm used to.
Uh-huh.
I don't think she cares what I say. I think she's going to care what I say about her.
Right.
But she did an interview with Bret Baier of Fox News. Some people say it was a Hail Mary to try and like say, look, I can go into the lion's den in Fox News. And,
oh, okay. So Fox News is
Fox News
very
is
much Republican.
Not, for the most part, yes.
Okay.
And Bret Baier, I thought he did fine. Of course, the Kamala camp will say, I just did it the other way. Kamala. Who knows what I'm going to say in any given moment. Kamala, see? The Kamala camp, of course, says he was unfair and he interrupted her and things like that. But if you watch this, and I'm not just saying this, if you watch this, it she freezes up. She doesn't quite know how to answer it. She says the name Donald Trump 37 times, and she turns everything back around. So I posted a clip of him asking her why they haven't done anything about these policies that she's claiming in the last 3.5 years. She's been in office.
Right.
She's vice president, but she's still been there. And her response was kind of like, well, But Donald Trump's been running for, and she just froze. And it made no sense. She said
that's weird.
It was very strange.
And so it was kind of like a mini one-person debate, or?
Well, it was just a guy interviewing her.
Just an interview.
Bret was asking her questions. I've always thought Bret was fair. Some people will say.
So what are people saying that he wasn't fair about then?
Just that he was interrupting her and he was giving her all the difficult questions. Basically, he wasn't tossing her softballs like the other moderators that we watched did, in my opinion. She went in and somebody actually called her out on some bullshit and she kind of froze a little bit. And so, of course, both sides are playing. Kamala's side saying he was unfair and then the other side saying that she's an idiot and she couldn't answer a question. Bottom line for this is just Butthurt comments. We haven't started the debate yet. I posted this clip just because it was interesting. It was like, whoa. And this person, everybody, by the way, it was like 50 comments that were like, I can't believe this. Like this is a concern.
Yeah.
And this one guy gets on there and immediately puts up a, his emoji was a black middle finger. So I'm assuming he's black or he's representing black, but the emoji was a black middle finger at me.
Okay.
And he said, fuck Donald J. Trump, vote with 4 blue hearts. So, I mean, that's blue. So vote Democrat. Anybody who supports this shitbag, and it had the shit emoji. He's being clever with his emoji.
A lot of emojis action going.
Hates themselves if you vote for him. You hate your country. You live for division. You're a straight racist. Don't say you're not because you are. This clown with the clown emoji has no policies, runs off fear, hates women unless they are licking his shitty diaper. This guy has no place in our government. A-R-E, apparently, is how you spell our government. With 4 exclamation points. Save everyone the embarrassment and drop out. There's so much wrong with this, but this is exactly what we want, isn't it? For Butthurt comment of the show. Yeah. There's so much just opinion. It's like every false rhetorical statement that's been made about this man, and you just regurgitated it to me.
Well, and it's just like I've told certain people that I know and I'm close to. It's like when you make a comment, you want to make it where there's a conversation to be had, right? This doesn't make me want to have a conversation with this man. This just makes me want to, you know, if I'm a Trump supporter, just attack right back, right?
Or ignore him.
Or ignore him. Yeah.
Guess what I did?
Like, subscribe.
there's about 4 paragraphs. But I did what I said I would do, which is everything was completely respectful. I said, well, let me address your first issue. He said, if you vote for him, you hate your country. Well, here's why that's not true. You live for division. Well, here's why that's not true. I went through his points, even though there were none, and I still said,
did he come back with anything? No.
No, of course not. He won't. But people, this is the exact Butthurt comment we want. We call us all kinds of shit. Give me a middle finger. Give me emojis. You know, do a whole post with emojis.
That is funny about the emojis.
But does that make it more powerful when he says this clown and then actually puts a clown face? I like, oh, damn, this guy.
Well, it makes me wonder how old he is at that point with all the emojis. Or is he trying to hit on you with the emojis?
I don't know.
Did he put an eggplant in there somewhere?
There was no eggplant. Just a middle finger.
Little water squirts?
There were some blue hearts, but I think that's for the Democratic Party. Mm. The water squirts. That's the best one. That's a whole nother conversation. We want. So that's Butthurt comment. Simple as that.
Yeah.
whatever, right? How about we do some news? All right, let me stop it. This is interesting, Trey.
How do I know it's interesting?
Well, I'm going to tell you why. Okay. Most of the stories tonight are quick, but this one's actually has some substance to it. There's a Kentucky man, that's all we need to say, named Anthony Thomas T.J. Hoover.
That's his whole name?
His nick is, the T.J. was in quotes, so I'm assuming
that's what it goes by.
So Anthony Thomas T.J.
Hoover. Okay.
So this guy, to give you kind of the synopsis really, very fast, drug overdose, cardiac arrest.
Damn.
And he went into a hospital and was declared dead. His family pulled the plug because they said he was brain dead. That's just the beginning of this story.
Oh, please tell me he woke up.
They were in the middle. Oh, by the way, he's an organ donor.
So they were in the middle of surgery.
He was in the middle. As soon as they decided that he was brain dead, they pulled the plug. They said, all right, let's go test his organs and make sure he's a donor, which is commendable. Sometimes I am and sometimes I'm not. When I renew, it depends on how I feel that day. I'm like, no, fuck everyone. Or I'm like, you know what? That's a solid.
Yeah. Lord knows they're not going to want your liver, but go ahead.
God damn it, though. Well played, Trey. Can't argue with you on that. All my other parts are good, but you don't need my liver. It's got some work to do. So the catheter was straight in his heart. They were testing his heart out.
Okay.
And Nicoletta Martin, who is an organ preservationist, said he wasn't as brain dead as he should have been during the procedure.
Holy shit. He started screaming? This fucking hurts?
He was, he woke up and started screaming.
Seriously?
Oh, yeah. He woke up and was shaking, but he was sedated, and the process carried on. They ended up saying that he was all good, everything was fine now, that was just whatever, and his organs were perfect for harvesting. So they wheeled him into the operating room to actually do the procedures. These were the tests. Right? So they wheeled him by his family, which is a kind of a tradition. His family says goodbye as he goes by to give his organs. And he opened his eyes and he started looking from family member to family member.
It's like, where am I going?
His sister, Donna Rohrer, said, his eyes were tracking us. Hold on. This is her quote. His eyes were tracking us around. But we were told
like he was alive.
We were just told it was reflexes. It was normal.
No.
Who were we to question the medicine, medical, the doctors?
Right.
So Hoover went on into the operating room.
Oh, my God.
Natasha Miller, another organ preservationist. Basically, what that means is they put the organs on ice.
In the coolers? Yeah.
That's what they do. She said the following. He was moving and he was panicked.
Maybe we should stop.
Tears were coming down his eyes.
Holy shit.
And she looked at the doctor and the surgeon and said, last I knew, dead men don't cry.
Yeah.
My notes. The doctors finally threw up their hands and said, I don't want to deal with this. I'm not going to touch this guy.
You think?
Miller, the preservationist, said it was very chaotic in the room. Investigations are underway. The family has gone public to try and reform the harvesting process.
Holy shit.
Hoover, his speech, his memory, and his balance are all out of whack.
Damn.
He's alive. His sister says that she has now lost faith in humanity.
Wow.
What do you think of that?
I don't understand the lost faith in humanity. I mean, he's still...
Well, but she's saying that they were... I mean, what happens if this one woman hadn't said, hey, this is kind of fucked up? I mean, what if they went through with it and they killed him? And she's sitting there going, these are supposed to be doctors that help us.
Those are prime organs then, too, if he was still alive like that.
The catheter was in his fucking heart.
It's fucking crazy. And so, can you imagine being sedated and not being able to do shit?
Well, that's what they're saying. When he woke up, he was like, and he realized what was going on, I guess. I don't know. I don't know if he remembered having a heart attack or... But he realized they were cutting into him. He started panicking.
Can you imagine seeing your heart get pulled out? Put that in the cooler. Wait, what?
I just think it's funny that she's like, well, dead people don't really cry. There's tears running down his face.
That's
and
wild.
His eyes are moving around. The family was just like, oh, that's normal. Bye. Goodbye.
He had a good run.
Yeah, look. And he's looking at us as he's about to give his organs. Anyway.
That's fucking scary.
Yeah, that's scary. So that's...
I don't know if I'm going to become an organ donor now.
Yeah, don't. Because you know what? If you weren't, maybe they would have waited long enough and figured out you were still alive.
Although I know somebody would come and say, well, he wanted to be cremated.
Exactly.
Fuck.
You're 1 foot in the fire. You're like, I'm alive.
I'm alive, damn it. I like that toe.
Anyway. All right. That was that story. That was a little more in depth. But here's some quick ones for you. You need to know, people. U.S. Customs and Border Protection, which we'll get to in the debate, they deal with smuggling attempts daily, correct?
Okay.
So in Presidio, Texas, which is a border crossing, they stopped somebody that had 748 pounds of Mexican bologna.
You just had a big dick.
40 rolls of meat were hidden in suitcases around the car.
Never of all the bologna things, again.
Yeah. So the CBP, Customs and Border Protection.
Okay.
Director Benito Reyes Jr., he said, the concern with pork is that they can introduce foreign animal diseases that can devastate U.S. economy and agricultural growth. Well, seems like a good enough reason for me to get the bologna the fuck out. And the driver was American, and it was only $1,000 civil punishment penalty. He paid the fine, and he moved on, and that was it.
That's a lot of sandwiches.
But the bologna was all destroyed.
Was it destroyed? They just have a party.
I don't know. Next time I go to a party, there's like 18 bologna sandwiches. I'll be like, what country is this from?
Right. Everything's so bologna.
But I just want to know, of all the things that can be smuggled in, why bologna?
Why bologna, yeah.
So you need to know that. Look, people, there are more problems at the border than just people coming in. There's bologna coming.
Maybe they're trying to put Oscar Mayer out of business.
Look, I'm telling you, we need strong borders.
Yeah.
We'll get to it.
Oscar Mayer's going to be pushing for it, too.
This may be added to our immigration.
Yeah.
And border security.
We're back. We need basically advertising, too. So, Oscar Mayer, if you're out there.
We're interested.
We're trying to help you out.
So, how about this? A single engine plane, small plane, very small plane, took off from Myrtle Beach. Minutes into the flight, a door fell off.
Holy shit.
And landed in a yard at a house that was vacant. The pilot, just to let you know, the pilot and the passenger on the plane were unharmed. It's a small...
Nobody got hit by the door.
Right. No one got hit. The witness, Wendy Hodges, who lived next door to the house where the door landed, after hearing about this, she went home immediately and checked it out. She found it intact in the yard, just the plane door. And she goes, we're lucky no one was hurt.
Oh, no.
Listen to this. She says, as a matter of fact, as she looked up, there's a plane flying right now. I will always start looking up when there's a plane flying overhead. First off, are you really going to do that every time there's a plane in the sky? Second off, what the fuck are you going to do if a door is coming at 8 million miles an hour at your face? You can't.
Nothing.
I just thought it was hilarious that this neighbor was like a witness, and she's like, you know, I'm going to start looking up. This proves that things can fall.
I say, what is this the only thing that's falling out of the sky? I hope, because I can't imagine.
There was, wasn't there a story about a bunch of like poo coming out of the plane bathroom? I don't remember all of our stories.
Isn't it frozen by the time it gets down though?
It could be, but that would hurt harder. That would hurt more, hurt harder. But you and I have done some stories in the past, and I don't know. That sounds like something we would do.
Yeah, I'm sure we would. Yeah.
All right, you're going to love this one. That one was just basic. I just thought the reaction of the neighbor was funny. I'm going to start looking up. Like you could do a damn thing about it. Was she going to dodge it?
Right.
Is this going down? Her whole life.
And what's the likelihood it happens again?
Yeah, exactly. Her whole life. Oh, fuck, there's a plane way up. Oh, there's another plane. Oh, no.
No.
She's being silly. She's silly. Silly Susan. I think Susan.
How come they didn't use speed tape on that door?
That's very true. We need to ask our pilot or Gorilla
Glue. Maybe they use speed tape and they need duct tape and glue. Gorilla Glue. Sorry, go ahead.
Anybody that didn't listen to the episode, please go back and listen to, I think it was in like season 2 with our pilot friend Tim. You know, I just told him I looked out one day and there was duct tape on the wing and it made me nervous. And he says it wasn't duct tape. I said, I know what duct tape looks like. And we went into this huge discussion about, then he said the windows had glue on.
Shit. And the speed tape covers the glue.
Speed tape covers it. He said the speed tape covers cracks or damage. Anyway.
Just made it worse.
He dug a hole and we didn't help him out at all.
No, we pushed him right into it.
You're going to love this. Cody Adams from Oklahoma. He had a court appearance in Pawnee County for car theft charges, which is 30 minutes away.
Okay.
From where he was in Stillwater. I think Oklahoma State. University's there. Adams couldn't find a ride. He was trying to bum a ride from patrons at a gas station in Stillwater to get to his court appearance for car theft. So he stole an unoccupied LifeNet emergency services pickup.
Holy shit.
So a highway trooper followed him and caught him at the courthouse, and he let him make his court appearance.
And then arrested him.
And then he was transported back to Payne County and booked on charges of car theft.
Well, at least he can walk to this court appearance this time. God,
you can't make this up.
Not at all. Not at all.
That's the funniest shit I've ever heard. Oh, I got to get my court appearance for car theft. Let me steal a car.
That's fucking hilarious. All right.
How about this? Do you have any fetishes, Trey?
I'm sure I do.
Foot fetish?
No.
I've never understood the foot fetish, but
I don't either.
However, there's a man, Jesse Johnson, who does. 28 years old, arrested in Gilbert, Arizona, on alleged instances of staring at women's feet at a car wash. What would happen is when they were vacuuming their car, he would pull up next to them and slide under their car.
That's so fucking creepy.
And just stare at their feet. One victim who saw him said she still has nightmares about the man under her car. It wasn't the first time that Johnson had law issues regarding feet. There were four times at least in Nebraska that he touched women's ankles in grocery stores. And that's it.
That's wild.
Oh, here's more. I was hoping that wasn't it. Look, I have notes, people. Johnson admitted to the police, "I'm sexually attracted to women's feet. At times I can't control myself and those desires." The charges are 3 counts of voyeurism, 3 counts of disorderly conduct, and he's being held right now on $10,000 bond.
Where was this at again?
Arizona.
Arizona, okay.
We haven't heard much about Arizona.
No?
All right.
That's wild. Can you imagine walking through the supermarket just seeing a man, grown-ass man, just bend over and start touching the ankle?
We don't have the foot fetish, so...
I guess I don't understand, yeah. But, I mean, it's not like I'm going to walk up and touch somebody's ass, you know? So it's like...
Well, that's true. Yeah, I mean, we have ass fetishes.
I mean, come on.
I don't think we'd be successful if we just started grabbing ass.
No. What if we grab each other's asses? Well, are you going to tell on me?
I won't press charges.
Okay.
We'll see.
We'll see.
Last story of the night. Hannah Willow, an American tourist. This hits home, no pun intended, because this took place where I lived for a couple of years. She's an American tourist, and she showed up to the Scottish tree-hugging in Glasgow, Scotland.
Is it an event? Like a tree-hugging event?
Yeah, it was. Okay. Well, she thought it was a tradition and a charity event, right?
Okay.
Everybody shows up and they hug the trees. Yeah,
is this a real thing?
Outside of Glasgow, yeah.
Did you go tree-hug?
No, I didn't do that. I was unaware. And it was, in fact, an actual competition.
A tree-hugging competition?
Yeah, competition. Okay. Tree-hugging. She said, "When I found out it was a competition, the inner child in me took on."
Oh no!
it took me on an internal somersault.
She said. Okay.
This was a moment of glory for me. Now she is training for the World Tree Hugging Championships in Halepu Forest, Finland.
Interesting. Well, how did she qualify for the world? Did she just sign up?
Because she won the Glasgow.
She did.
She won. I'll get there.
She didn't even mean to.
She didn't mean to. She is now strategizing how to win the world. She said, "I may have to step up my game. I'll have to bring out my fairy wings and my ukulele and sing to the trees first." Willow said this has caused friction between her and her 3 daughters, who were embarrassed as soon as she won in Glasgow.
Wow.
And things went south.
Does it say how long she was hugging the tree?
I don't know.
Golly.
How do you win that? I mean, do you hug it with...
Nobody ever wins.
...intensity? I mean, is it like a... I don't know. I mean...
Mine would be covered in ants, I know.
For some reason, I remember us doing a story about a guy that was like banging a tree.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
In England.
Yeah, and had sex with a tree.
It's, yeah, but so it's, yeah, hugging a tree is not quite as intense. But,
no, no.
But is there, there's a world competition. I thought maybe Glasgow was like, okay, we just the this regionals. Is just fun. It's a regional. It's in that area. And that all of a sudden she decided she was going to dedicate her life to the World Tree Hugging Championship.
Is there any money involved?
It didn't say. It's caused friction with her daughters.
How old are the daughters? How old is she? You're horrible with these details.
I only give you what I'm told.
Gotcha.
She must be, I mean, you can do the math.
I'm going to have to Google this.
Well, her daughters are adults. I know that much.
Okay.
So she's probably, I mean, I would imagine
she's an adult also.
50s or 60s, and her daughters are in their 20s or 30s. That's what I would think.
Well, then why would they care then?
If your mom went to Glasgow
and won a regional.
Well, that's fine. But if she dedicated the rest of her life to winning the World Tree Hugging Championship and said something about ukuleles and fairies.
Ukuleles would throw me off. Wait a minute. The ukulele, isn't that the little mini
That's
guitar?
The mini guitar.
How are you supposed to play that if you're hugging a tree?
No, she's going to serenade the tree so that the tree looks like it's like before she hugs it. It's almost like you're.
She's setting it up.
You don't understand.
I get it now.
Get it, Trey.
I understand. I was like, how the fuck is she going to play a ukulele while she's hugging a tree, though? But now she's setting it up, setting the mood.
Well, if it's a small tree, you can be around it like this.
That's true.
This is maybe the dumbest story we've ever done.
I'm sure.
I like a few of those, and a few of those you just needed to hear.
Yeah.
If you're in Glasgow, which one of my favorite cities in the world, I loved living there, was unaware of this.
I can't believe you were unaware of this.
I don't think Glaswegians even are aware of this. I think it's some like cult.
I was about to say, you have a friend up there that should have told you about
this. I'm
going to
ask this friend that I have in Scotland if he's listening. Please reach out before I do.
I'm a little disappointed we don't have pictures of you hugging a tree.
Well, not me. I just want to see this.
In a kilt.
I just want to see it. That's it. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for what you've been waiting for.
Are you serious?
We have given you the news. We have given you the Butthurt comments. We have given you our headlines. We have done Stay in the Grave podcast to a T. What now is going to happen is something that could change your lives. Something that can change our lives. Something that can change the country, the world.
Dun, dun, dun.
And I think if you listen here, you're really going to get some perspective.
You're going to get something.
So after this quick break, we're going to take a quick break.
Thank goodness.
You will see the special, the special alternative candidates for president entering the room in the studio. To partake in a debate on the 6 most popular topics for the election. Are you ready for this?
No. Are you talking to the people or me?
Well, I was talking to the people, but now I'm talking to you.
Okay. Still no. How come we didn't have our caller call in for this?
I think we had technical difficulties and
we haven't figured that shit out yet.
He's still laughing about it because he thinks he would solve it in 2 seconds, but I don't think so. Whatever. But we do have a caller who thinks he's smart, kind of a smart ass, that wants to have a go at me. But I'm going to give you the first opportunity. And don't worry, people. I am a candidate. I am no longer pro this, pro that. I'm not on one side or the other. We're just going to talk about the issues, which is what everybody should be doing. And in all seriousness, Trey, for once, for give me 20 seconds of serious. 5 seconds of serious. This is what we try to do with the show, honestly.
Right.
We try and listen. We try and talk. We try and formulate opinions based on discussion. And that's what we're going to do here. We're just the two least qualified guys to do it.
Right.
But so is 80% of the population. So
right.
Let's listen and talk. And let's all come together and make a important decision.
Let's do it.
All right, you ready?
Yeah.
After these messages, the candidates will enter the room. So, Trey.
Yes.
Are you ready?
Do I get a mute button for you?
No.
Still no?
Still no. I think that most of the people listening would appreciate that, but that's not how these rules work. As you can hear, we have a studio audience tonight. The candidates have had issues. The presidential candidates, the real ones, have had issues with studio audience. Trey and I happen to like having people out in the audience. Applause. Why am I hearing crickets? So let's start. And in all seriousness, this is really a discussion between us, because I have been very adamant about who I'm voting for, because I do think there's more to this than just politics and an election. Humanity, everybody that listened to me ramble on the mountaintop, go listen if you haven't. I'm not a big fan right now of just the way that people treat each other. And politics should be kind of like the last thing you worry about when it comes to actual horrible treatment of people. And that's what's happening. So we have six categories, Trey. I'm going to let you go first. You won the coin toss. So we're going to start, and everybody can listen and learn from us.
What are we starting with?
You won the coin toss. I'm going to give you a choice. We have immigration, border. We have climate change, public safety, gun control. We have healthcare and education, foreign affairs.
Shit.
And abortion.
Oh. Let's do climate change.
Oh, he's going to start with climate change, the most unimportant of all of them, but that's okay. All right. You have, according to my timer, you have 2 minutes to give your case on climate change and how, what's important to you about climate change and the candidate that you're going to vote for. And go.
So, I'm going to start
with. So, I think that. Go ahead.
Mute. Clean energy investment. So, I want to start with incentivizing the transition to renewable energy, solar, wind, and hydro. Is hydro weed? Isn't that hydro? Through tax credits and subsidies that can reduce carbon emissions while creating green jobs.
Okay.
Second, carbon pricing. Implementing a carbon tax or cap and trade system to put a price on carbon emissions can encourage companies to reduce their environmental impact. Sustainable agriculture. I'm glad we weren't prepared with these questions. Supporting farmers in adopting sustainable practices like reduced pesticide use and water conservation can help mitigate the environmental effects of agriculture. And then my final point, Ryan, climate adaptation funding. That's a big word. Investing in infrastructure to help communities adapt to rising sea levels, extreme weather, and other climate-related challenges can build resilience.
You have 45 seconds left. Are you good? Would you like to pass?
Go ahead, sir.
All right, stop. Okay, my retort. What the fuck was that?
Did that not sound legit?
But was this what you want in the candidate? It sounded legit. Your reading skills are very good.
You like that?
But is this what you're wanting the candidate for presidency to do, is all these things? Or are you just trying to sound like you know something?
I would assume clean energy would be a good thing, right?
Well, but are we ready for it?
That's a good question.
That's a good question. So my retort, I've given 30 seconds.
When you say, are we ready, like me and you
not
the world?
We're not ready for shit. You, the world. What I believe is that there's a way to work towards it without going from point A to Z. Like there's a way to work.
There's a progression.
There's a progression. Thank you, Trey. Look at that. Word of the day, toilet paper.
Toilet paper.
God, that was the best investment I ever made. And I feel like from a climate change perspective, people are so riled up. It's either climate change is a hoax or climate change is, oh my God, we're going to die in 10 years.
Right.
And my problem with whatever candidate might push this is there's nothing wrong with researching climate change. But to be so scared of it and to not understand that we cannot possibly track billions of years of the Earth's climate, I just feel like all the things you just said, which sounded very, very smart, you can't jump from, let's say, solar power, hydro, which was hilarious, by the way. I think that means water.
And wind.
And wind. You know how much one of those wind things costs? It's
like the windmills?
Yeah, those plastic fuckers out there in the middle.
Are they super pricey?
They're pretty pricey. And
aren't solar panels super? Like, well, you want to put a solar?
Right, but what if it's not sunny? And that's the point, is it's kind of like, well, let's...
It's always sunny here, though.
It's true. We might benefit more than others. But the point being is that those things are great when they work, but there's nothing wrong with having fossil fuels, which is what I want to do as a candidate. And fracking and taking out our own energy and resources and not depending on other countries for it because solar isn't working, because there are days it's just not ready yet. Now, if we can ever get to that point, fuck yeah.
So would you? How long would you say it would be, give or take, in your opinion, until it's ready?
Well, we just have to figure out how to, in my... I'm trying to sound like I know what the fuck I'm talking about. I admit this may sound ridiculous, but there's got to be a way to harness it to where it's almost like a backup. It's like a reserve to where solar energy can be harnessed in when it's available on days when you're not going to get that energy.
And then you hold on to
it. And you have it to use. Clean energy and all that's great. Who wouldn't want that? Okay.
Right.
That's the point. Who wouldn't want it? But is it attainable and is it realistic? Again, I make jokes about, you know, look, I love Elon now because he's kind of seen the light a little bit, and he's all about electric cars and obviously with Tesla and these things, but he's not unrealistic. He's saying, yeah, there's still ways to go.
When there are issues about the batteries for these electric cars,
yeah, batteries and the what it takes to charge them. I mean, it's just hilarious.
I thought there's issues with like even harvesting those batteries.
Oh, I don't know about all that. Mm. You should have brought those notes with you.
Well, it didn't pull up when I pulled up these five questions.
Okay. So you're saying you would like a candidate to move towards all these things, like, let's put a lot of money into it. I'm saying, let's be reasonable. We only have certain spending. Let's research it, but let's not go crazy. Let's not sit here and say in 15 years our poor kids are going to be underwater. So that's my thought.
So you're more budget friendly, and I'm ready to spend money.
Yeah, you want to spend.
Okay.
And so is this true? Like in reality, you're ready to like put money into this?
No. No, I don't know.
Okay.
So let me look at my notes again.
So no, that's okay. So this issue may not sway you on who you're going to vote for.
Right.
Okay. Well, I need a drink. Okay. That's my point is I don't like frivolous spending, and I think that doing research on it's fine, but freaking out is... Look, some of the most biggest climate change activists, celebrities or politicians all have beachfront property. Well, if the water's going to rise, then why do you have that? And they fly private jets, which have emissions that...
I mean, we're already frivolously spending. Why don't we spend some more?
Okay. You know what? My retort was 5 minutes to 27 seconds.
How come I get the presidency and then I don't get to spend money? What the fuck is that?
It's true. You need to spend it the right way. Let's move on.
Okay.
Would you like to choose? I'm gonna let you choose the topics. This is fun. All right. Do you want them over again?
Was public safety and crime one of them?
Yes, it was. You want to go public safety and gun control?
Yeah, we'll do that.
Public safety, gun control. Would you like me to start or would you like to start?
I don't know how to retort.
So you want to start? Go ahead.
You can start.
No. Talk. I'm ad-libbing because I'm that confident.
So community policing,
okay,
is my first point.
All right. We had a former police officer at the university.
Yeah. Investing in programs that foster positive relationships between police and communities can reduce tensions.
Good. I might learn. I'm going to learn something here.
And build trust. I think I remember this in my textbook, leading to more effective crime prevention. So basically, you get all these areas that are bad areas. And of course, if gangs run the area, you know what? If they fuck something up, nobody talks, you know? So right. It's like, if they figure out a community plan together to say, hey, you know what? If you're just going to let these guys run the neighborhood, nothing's ever going to get better because people are scared to talk. So.
Right. So what's the solution?
We need to figure out a community program to build those relationships.
Okay.
So they'll start ratting on people. Here's an interesting one. Criminal justice reform policies aimed at reducing mandatory minimum sentences, decriminalizing minor drug offenses, and addressing mass incarceration can create a fairer justice system.
What about mass incarceration? Decreasing it?
Addressing
it.
So mass incarceration.
A lot of people are saying that they're unhappy with the amount of people that are in the jails for kind of like bullshit
reasons.
And that if you take that away and you address the major issues, then it look, I'm all for strict punishments for the major issues.
Absolutely.
And I'm all for lightening up a little bit on others. I mean, that. How do I do this? I'm not supposed to be talking about one of the candidates or the other. But one of the candidates, who was a prosecutor in San Francisco, California, you know, had some pretty hefty charges on, and not just her, others as well, hefty charges for marijuana possession.
This was in California, really?
Yeah, and this is before it was legal, of course, and they kept him in there to do work, and there's some shady stuff that went on, and I just feel like the base charges on something like that. I mean, if you ran a whole ring and there were like deaths and things like that, that's different. But I mean, possession, come on, even distribution to a point seems a little extreme, and it fills your jails. And
well, not to mention it also
you're paying sends, for them to be there.
It sends what may be a simple pothead into a prison where they have to now survive.
Sure.
And so now
and their life is over.
Right. And so they come out and they're probably worse off than when they went in.
I want to know about the people that are in there now for marijuana distribution or possession. And now that it's legal, did they stay in or did they go?
I think they stayed in, actually. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's not grandfathered.
Mm.
Okay. Well, and so when it comes to that, I'll let you, your brilliant analysis that was not prescripted, do the talking about that. Because there also is gun control. And again, we have to, this is so hard.
Exactly where I was about to talk about next.
Okay, well, I'll let you go next. This is so hard to get through because we have six topics and we a limited amount of time, but gun control, Trey and I have talked about extensively. I would say extensively. We've talked about it on at least 5 to 10 shows. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, talk about gun control. Trey and I, this is one of the things that we agree on, so it's not going to be much of a debate. Aren't we supposed to, like, compliment? I agree with the gentleman sitting across from me on this. However, he's a douche. And your running mate's a fuck. Go ahead.
So this one says, introducing universal background checks.
Okay.
Closing loopholes. I don't understand what that might mean. And implementing red flag laws to keep guns out of the hands of dangerous individuals can help reduce gun violence. That makes absolutely no sense because the law-abiding citizens that can go through these background checks and get a gun legally will do this. They will go through the waiting and the paperwork and all that bullshit.
They won't like it, but they'll do it.
Right. But if you know you're not going to meet these standards, you just go down the street, go to a corner, whatever the case may be, as guns are easy to get. So it's like, I don't understand this part of it. I don't think this will fix anything myself. It's just, it's going to make law-abiding citizens go through more and more and more. So,
right. And I agree with you. And I think that's more of a right-wing view.
Is that Republican?
Republican.
Okay.
That would be Donald Trump. I'm going to do it because I thought I'd go back through them, but then I keep throwing them away and now I don't have them. So on this issue, you're leaning more towards the Trump side, the people that are sitting here going Second Amendment, blah, blah, blah. Gun We need checks. We need background checks.
Right, right.
We need even psychological examinations. I'm okay with. There's a gray area here, hence the name of our show. You cannot. You and I both agree. We've talked about it. We cannot just collect guns. That's not going to work.
Never
work.
Stupid. Yeah, no.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Because the good people will be like, all right, well, fine. I don't want to get in trouble. So here. But the bad guys are going to be like, well, you know, fuck you. Why would I? Why am I going to?
Yeah.
Do this.
It's not even registered, you know.
Yeah, so. It's not even. Yeah, I mean, the serial numbers are scraped off, and so that's dumb. So what's the solution? The solution to me is intense training, background checks, make ammo super expensive. I mean, I know there'll be a market for that too. I get it, but do whatever it takes to make it really not difficult, but make it an effective way to get a gun. If you want a gun, you have to like literally prove yourself. I think you should have to take a class. I don't think you should be able to walk into a gun store and buy a gun right now without having some sort of gun training or background checks. And a lot of the gun enthusiasts will get mad at me for saying that.
I think a lot of it also
a neutral ground, isn't it?
I think a lot of it comes also down to the community programs. If you start going back to these communities, working within these communities, one, maybe they start saying, hey, there's guns in this house. Boom, that takes them off the streets. You have kids that are growing up. If you have them in some type of community program as they're growing up, as opposed to hanging out on the streets,
right,
that keeps them away from guns. That's a huge part, I think, that would help out a lot.
Gun education. I mean, just simple. But that gets into a whole thing where, you know, I feel like it starts with the youth, which we agree with. We need role models. We need people to help the youth, to make them believe that there's more than what they're seeing, which is gun violence and gangs and things like that. For the most part, I mean, obviously there are more gun issues than just like gang violence. Mental health issues that we talked about couple shows with Drew. Counselors, things like that, that can and then spot some behavior that might turn into something more. It's not an easy topic at all. So, but the bottom line is that one side wants to take all your guns and they blame it on AR or whatever, which
types of guns, yeah,
the types of guns, and that's just not. It's ineffective. It's not going to do anything. It's beyond that, and I think you and I both agree that mental health and all these other checks in order to get a gun are priority.
Huge, yes. And I actually like here recently when they held up the parent liable the shooting.
And that's not every state. That's just a couple. And
so I thought that's a huge idea because then parents need to start asking questions. What are their kids doing?
Ones that are legitimately like responsible. I mean, I think
some of them
really don't know, then I think that's up to the courts and hopefully the...
But you know what? Parents need to start staying in their lives, you know, asking questions. It's hard. But...
What was the last topic we had? Because I'm going to tell you where you were on that. Climate change?
Yeah.
Yeah, you were probably more Kamala on that.
Was it Kamala?
Kamala.
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 You were more there, so you were left on that. And then we talked about, this was only the second topic.
Yeah.
We better move on.
Move on.
All right. We've got immigration and the border security, abortion, foreign affairs, or healthcare and education.
We can do healthcare because that's nice. I don't have immigration.
Healthcare and education. Let's roll. What do you have for me?
Creating a public option or expanding Medicare to allow more citizens to buy into government-sponsored healthcare programs can increase access and affordability.
You sound so smart. All that sounded like to me is a bunch of mumbo jumbo about...
is that word salad?
Word salad. And I've got it here on some of these other notes. I was going to bore all of you and just give you some of the points on both sides and let Trey decide. But this is more fun. I think what you're saying is more about, I want you to read it again, but I don't.
I mean, it boils down to insurance that more people can get. So it's like, how do we get people more access to more insurance access?
Okay.
Ability. How'd you pour? You said you weren't going to pour another one. Anyway.
No. I said I had one left after that.
Oh.
My thought on this is everybody thinks it's more accessibility. But with Obamacare, which is the Affordable Care Act, ACA, correct? Which is what is being pushed by the Democratic side. And then, of course, Donald Trump wants to eliminate that. Obamacare was what it was initially called. The problem is that there aren't, you don't get to choose your doctor. Mm-hmm. You're basically assigned a network that you have to choose from. And it's to me, being a patient of a doctor, I don't know about you, you know, I want somebody that I kind of feel comfortable with.
Yeah.
And I don't want to have to be told who to have. And then, of course, then you've got private medicine, which is a whole different topic that's away from that. And it, to me, the rates of Obamacare are not what they were promised to be. And there's a bunch of issues with it. And that's why a guy like Donald Trump has said, look, we're going to start over on this. Now, admittedly, he didn't get it done in 4 years. I feel like I'm talking like him. Admittedly, he didn't get it done in 4 years. Sometimes you need a little longer, I guess. But you know, the whole idea was repeal and replace Obamacare. So that's the only thing I have really there. So what do you think? Do you, you don't know much about Obamacare except for what you just read me?
Correct.
Okay. So.
Although I did hear a lot about as far as it also hurt businesses, right? Where it made it more difficult for companies to provide
definitely,
insurance.
Definitely so. More. There were issues there, again, the network and where people were located and the states and this and that and whatever. So I'll ask you to reflect on this on your own. I won't pressure you. But again, the one side is basically mandating and forcing you. They were penalizing people financially if you didn't get Obamacare.
To get it, I thought it was just you didn't have insurance coverage at that point. Then.
Well, you had to get Obamacare, and if you didn't do it, you were fined. Are you kidding me?
Yeah,
that's my problem with it. Is that's not freedom. That's not, and I know that sounds.
Freedom. And what does that help with, though? Freedom. I mean, if they don't want it, then
exactly.
So,
and so it never made sense to me in that regard. And so I don't want this one anymore. I want something new. And if it, but get something new. I mean, I'm not going to give Donald a break here and say that, you know, you need to get something new.
We got smart people that should be able to figure
exactly,
this out, right?
Exactly. And it's not him. And he's admitted it. He's like, I'm going to get people that know to do this. Mm-hmm. People forget that it's not everything that all that we're talking about is not. All going to be his decision. It's not like he's sitting there making all these calls. He's hiring people to make the decisions and to help him. All right. Again, time's sake.
Prescription drug price regulation.
That's a good one. Okay, let's add to that. Go ahead really quick.
Implementing price controls or allowing Medicare to negotiate drug prices can reduce the cost burden on patients. See, isn't this a big pharma thing? You know, how are they going to want to, they're not going to want to negotiate. They're making money hand over fist.
No, big pharma is an issue.
Isn't America the only country that actually advertises medication on TV?
That's what I heard. I don't know if it's true. I never saw it in Great Britain.
Right.
In fact, they had a hard time, Trey, and I'll give you a personal experience. They had a hard time giving me the medication that I had here in the States. Mm-hmm. When I went over there, met with a doctor for free because it's universal health care, and then the doctor was fine, but the care was poor because it was free, and you don't get the highest quality
right
when things are free. You just don't.
And you probably had to wait.
And everybody, somebody coughs once and they're in the emergency room, and people are actually having chest pains and, you know, whatever, and they're in line because people are going in there. And there's a way that they need to figure out universal health care. So they didn't want to give me what they call tablets. That's what my doctor said, tablets. They didn't want to do that. In order to get that, they had to come and have them shipped from Canada. They didn't even go to the U.S. for them. They went to Canada for what I was on. Which was basic antidepressant, which we've talked about on the show before.
Right.
A Lexapro type, small dose Lexapro type.
Did they not like that medication or what?
No, they just don't believe in it. They think that it's there are ways to fix it without medication. They're just not a big pharma medication. And I don't know if I agree with that. For two people that are sitting here that have dealt with anxiety and dealt with different issues related to that, I don't know. I mean, I why not just help it out?
Well, but, I mean, I know how I felt when I was on antidepressants, I could tell a difference. But then there was also things that was drawbacks from it, you know, both sexually and my boss.
I never had that issue. Go ahead.
But my boss even said I seemed very flighty, you know, all over the place, not focused. And it might just have been the medication I was on, but I could definitely tell I was happy as shit.
Yeah.
And so.
Well, there's a difference also between the antidepressants and the benzodiazepines, which is your Xanax, your Ativan, I believe, those types of anti-anxiety medication, which is more like a tranquilizer. And those are, they hated those in the UK. In order to get those, it was like a whore. And of course, I was panicked because I needed them.
Right.
I was addicted to them. It was benzodiazepines. They're known to be addictive. And so, anyway, the point being is that the United States has a pharmaceutical issue. I agree. But both candidates, and I've got it in front of me here, if the camera's on, it might not be. Every time I say that, they don't put it on. I think they're just fucking with me. Thanks, guys. And but what I've got in front of me here says both candidates are trying to reduce the cost of pharmaceuticals.
Gotcha.
I
wonder if that's even possible, though.
I can't imagine that one candidate's going to be like, yeah, let's fucking raise it. Let's, you know.
Yeah.
And the insulin was a big deal for diabetics.
Absolutely.
The Democrats say that they capped it. The Republicans say they capped it. Look, my wife is type 1, and she said that nothing really changed between the two when Trump was president and when Biden was president. So if anybody, either side, can do that, that'd be great.
So let me ask you a question. Maybe this is insensitive. I don't know. But what's the medication
that's what we do here?
They give you when you overdose?
I don't know.
Is it Narcan? So there's a medication they give you if you overdose. It's supposed to help revive you.
Mm.
It's free.
Like a shot?
It's something up the nose.
I just remember Pulp Fiction.
Yeah, it's something up the nose that they give you that. It's up the nose.
They were trying to stab.
No, nose.
Okay, it's not Pulp Fiction.
I hope I said it right.
Well, you said it better than I did. I was stabbing like Pulp Fiction.
So that's free medication. How come? And that's for drug overdose.
But that's the point.
How come cancer medicine isn't free? How come insulin is not free?
That's the question.
So,
is whenever somebody gets themselves in a situation where they're fucked up and they don't know what to do, then all of a sudden it's like, well, let's help them. But if you're being a good citizen and you just happen to have this issue medically, then too bad. You're paying a shit ton of money.
Right.
And so both candidates are trying to lower it. And so I would say there you're neutral. Not one or the other isn't doing anything more for you in that regard.
Right.
Prescription drugs. I think it's something that one of them should have come out and really pushed. I didn't hear either of them do that. So, all right, three more real quick. Immigration border. Look, these are all the ones I want to talk about. Immigration border. I'm sure that prescription pills somehow have to do with the border and the illegals that are in here. Right?
I'm sure.
I'm supposed to be like J.D. Vance.
Right.
Every question has to do with the border.
The border, illegals. Yeah.
But you grew up in a middle-class family.
I did grow up in a middle-class family. I used to ride bicycles and
so your pharmaceutical needs are
grew up in a middle-class family. I played football in the yard, drank out of a water hose,
beat each other with sticks.
Yeah.
All right, immigration border, abortion.
Well, when we talk about abortion,
foreign affairs,
let's talk about abortion because I know shit about foreign affairs.
Hold on. Well, foreign affairs to me is simple. We've talked about it. Abortion.
All right. Abortion.
Abortion.
So before I discuss abortion, I want to talk about growing up as a middle class white male in America. But wait,
look, abortions wouldn't happen if the border wasn't open and immigrants weren't coming in.
Yeah, but abortion wouldn't happen if lunches were free
in the middle class,
in the schools to help kids eat.
For middle class family,
because I was a middle class.
But a lot of those middle class families were overrun by immigrants that were illegal.
Right.
This could go on all night.
But so anyway, abortion. I think we've talked about this.
We've talked about it a lot, and you and I we're close, but we're just a little off. So go ahead with your stance real quick.
I'm for abortion. I'm pro-choice.
You're not pro-abortion.
Pro-choice.
You're not pro-abortion. You're pro-choice.
Pro-choice,
yes. You just said you're for abortion.
Yeah.
You hope there's abortion.
That was bad.
Yeah, that sounded bad, but you know what? Everybody that watches will now see.
I'm pro-choice. Okay. You know, I guess, and unfortunately, people take advantage of circumstances, which is unfortunate.
Right.
I honestly feel like, you know what? Abortion should be legal. You go to a doctor. The doctor decides whether or not they want to perform the surgery, whatever the case may be. I think they should go that route, you know, until they find.
You want to trust the doctor.
Trust the doctor to make a medical decision on whether or not the abortion is necessary. And I don't see how that's not a fair alternative, I guess is the best way to put it.
Retort my card. You did a story about a doctor who asked an 8-year-old how he identified.
Right.
Not all doctors are with it.
That's true.
That's my thought on that. Go ahead. I just wanted to say that not all medical decisions are the right ones, but go ahead.
But, you get on a plane, you hope the pilot is going to fly you to the right destination without killing you.
Right. Well, unless there's duct tape and Gorilla Glue.
Right. And in most cases, I would assume you go into a doctor, he's going to be competent enough to help you get to the right decision. And it's not like you go in there and they automatically take the baby, suck the baby out right then and there. You go through steps as far as...
I'm going to put a graphic on the bottom of this.
They send you home to think about it, see if this is actually what you want to do. There's some other steps in there that I forgot, but...
Who does?
The doctor. They don't
not do every it. Single doctor though.
They don't.
Are you saying every single doctor?
I thought it was a process.
I don't know.
I thought it was a Planned Parenthood process that you come in, they talk to you about
Parenthood. For Planned Parenthood.
But I thought this was a process for everybody.
It could be. I'm asking you.
I don't know if it's a process.
You definitely know it's like a Planned Parenthood thing.
Based on what I've personally gone through, they send you home to think about it.
Right.
You know, see if this is something you really want to do.
Right.
They educate you about how it goes, this, that, and the other. So it's a couple day process before they even will agree to do the process on you.
Okay.
So I
don't mind that. I think that's a good thing.
So, you know, I think that's a good thing.
I think you and I analyzed a guy that was comparing that to getting a gun and taking the time to get versus, whatever.
Right.
But
I think if you leave, again, you hope the medical doctor is with it, you know, in his right mind and is knowledgeable. But I think if you leave the doctor to say, okay, hey, you are too far along to have this abortion, you know, how about give birth and then put it up for adoption type deal. Allow the doctor to make that medical decision to say, hey, you're too far along.
But why is that a medical decision unless the mother's at risk?
I would, you know.
But that's my problem is it's not, at that point, it's kind of like you're just wussing out. You should be able to say to yourself, the doctor can suggest that, hey, this is one of your options, adoption.
Right.
The other option is whatever. But my biggest problem with abortion is late term.
Right. And where is late term? Because, you know, can't you deliver a baby like... So it's 9 months is full term, right? So 6-7 months, can't you deliver a baby at that point?
The third trimester is 7, 8, and 9 is considered late term.
Yes.
I think months 4, 5, and 6 are very close to that. I still think that if you don't know by month 4, come on. I mean, that's my problem with it. I'm look, women, I love you all. All of our women listeners, Trey, we're still 52% to 48 on Spotify women listeners. Did you know that?
I didn't.
I love you all, and I want you and your bodies to be your decision. It's not about that. It's about the fact that I think you should be able to be as intelligent as women are. They rub it in our faces all the time. But by 4 months, 4 or 5 months, you should be able to know, here's what's going to happen. And if it gets beyond that, then it becomes a problem for me, because that child's spine has been connected to the brain. It's becoming a person. But if you get it, sounds really bad, but if you make that decision in the right amount of time, I think we had a guest on, I forget who it was, that was talking about, I don't agree with this whole like 4 to 6 week thing, because some people don't even know that they're pregnant until week whatever. But I think that you need to be able to make that decision before it gets to that second term. There's 3 terms, right?
And I'd be curious to know why you wouldn't be able to make it
3 trimesters.
Make an educated decision before that point.
The problem is, I think you have a lot of people that panic. They're like, oh, I'm going to have the baby, and they panic. And instead of saying, well, I'm going to have the baby and put it up for adoption, they panic and they want an abortion. Well, that's a little bit beyond my, I'm not okay with that. And that's my opinion. I am not fully 100% everything pro-life. Like I understand there are extenuating extenuating circumstances that rape, I mean, all these things that we hear about, right?
Incest, rape
incest, whatever that, okay. But you should know that before late term. There should be no reason, in my opinion, unless the mother's life is in danger, which is where your doctor comes into play, from months like 5 to 9, to have an abortion, unless your life is in danger as the mother.
But I think right now the problem is doctors don't know if still it's okay if this is considered a life-threatening issue. And now they're scared to do anything because they're afraid they're going to lose their license.
Well, true.
So when it comes to 7, 8, 9, I would think that's delivering a baby. And if you get rid of it after that, that's murder.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's my problem. 4, 5, and 6 is where it's tricky. I still believe that by month 4, if it's rape, if it's incest, if it's whatever, you should know. You know.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
But then.
Abortion before the spine connects, when it's people that are pro-choice like to say a cluster of cells. It is, but it's still going to turn into a life. And if you if you bring religion into it, which is the problem, the big dispute is that they believe that a soul begins at conception. As soon as that little tadpole hits that egg, it's a soul. It's not about being a human. It's about having a soul in religion, from the religious aspect of it. And that's why people get so fired up about abortion that are pro-life immediately. Like, no, you and I are talking where we should be, which is the gray area.
Mm-hmm.
Like the show name, Stay in the Gray podcast. But a lot of people are either no abortions no matter what, or leave me alone, I can have an abortion at 8 months if I want. And I have a problem with both. What do you think?
Say that part again. Yeah, you went from 1 to 8 months. Well,
what I was saying is that there are two sides to this. The pro-life people are like, no matter what, no
abortion. Oh, okay, I'm with you.
The pro-choice people are like, I can have an abortion at 8 months or 9 months or 7 months or whenever. And there's a middle ground. There's extenuating... Again, that word, extenuating circumstances that might call for, you might have analyzed it at month 4 or 5, but I believe in most cases you should know by month 4 or 5, whether it's rape, incest, whether you do whatever. I think it should be, There should, once it gets past that point, you're having the child. Well, that's my opinion.
I think the biggest issue right now then is the fact that there's so many gray areas that doctors don't know if it fits in a gray area, if it fits in that little box that says, okay, well, it's okay to do it. I think that's where the issue is doctors need to be able to do what they need to do for the patient that they're working with, right? And I think for the people that really need it, no matter the time frame, because it has health issues or something like that, I think that's where the issue is coming into play, where doctors don't know, okay, is this health issue valid enough for me to do this right. abortion, and it's leading to worse things happening right. to the woman. So,
well, I think a doctor can make a decision on whether a woman is at risk, if the mother is at risk.
Right. What's enough at risk to fit into this criteria sure. to do the abortion and not right. lose my doctor's or my license, you know? So I think that's what a lot of stories I've seen come out yeah. is, hey, they told me I was not sick enough. So I ended up going septic until they finally right. were able to do the abortion. Well, now I can't have kids again. Well,
that's the
you
problem.
Know?
It's so, a cluster. That's the problem right. is that instead of saying, that was my point. Instead of saying, no abortions ever, or oh, I can get an abortion whenever I want. It's my body. Fuck you, men or whoever. There's got to be, the doctors have to feel comfortable, and there's got to be a way for everybody to come together and say, hey, let's talk case by case. Let's talk, again, all the different circumstances, right?
That's where I think it should go, is
yeah. well,
give it to the doctors.
The problem is that each side of these candidates are, you know, I'll throw this out here and we'll move on. Just again, we're way over, but I'll move on because of time's sake. But the one side is don't touch my body. I'll do whatever I want, which is pro-choice.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The other side is the pro-choice side is claiming the other side is only pro-life no matter what, mm-hmm. okay? But I'll say it. Donald Trump has made it clear that it is not, he's not going to approve, he'll veto any national ban on abortion. He'll veto it. All he did was give it to the states. We've talked about this.
Right, but how frustrating is that to
I get it.
To go to another state
but
if you can afford it?
The bottom line is that different people in different, if there's 85% in one state that doesn't think it.
But you know what it's going to lead to? It's going to lead to women doing underground abortions
I get it.
And that kind of stuff.
I get it. This leads to another issue with your decision-making process. Is that one side wants to centralize government at the federal level.
Mm-hmm.
Kamala wants all these issues to be central government, American government, we're all the same. But in my opinion, we're not all the same. And Donald Trump and the Republican side, for the most part, wants to localize, give it to the states, and then as far as you can go, give it to the cities. To the mayors, give it as far as you can go to the people of the area have a say. In Texas, you have liquor licenses, or you have liquor in communities, in suburbs. They can decide, hey, we don't want to sell liquor here, and you can't find a liquor store.
Yeah,
and they're localizing it. So, which was the point of this constitutional republic that we live in. Centralized government in a country this size is very close to socialism and communism. It just is. When one group can control this entire country without giving a little bit of power to the states. And I'm not sitting here, I mean, it's obvious which side I'm on, but I'm not sitting here trying to tell you which side to be on. I'm just telling you that's the difference, is that one side wants to say, hey, abortions, whenever, however, whatever. Women's bodies, it's their choice. The other side is saying, let's give it to the states. Let's see what the region feels, and let's go from there. And I think you make a valid point. You're going to underground abortions, coat hanger abortions, if finding babies in dumpsters. It's sad.
I don't know if you know this, but I need to look it up if you don't. When did the need to make decisions on a woman's body become a government issue? Obviously, we know Roe v. Wade, but was there issues before Roe v. Wade? Obviously,
I just feel like, I'm really not 100% like pro-life, like Republican on this issue. But what you need to understand is that what's growing inside that woman is not her life. There's another life. Mm-hmm. At a certain point. And that's where people don't want to talk. They don't want to talk about the gray area like I do. If it's early enough, it's not necessarily a life if you don't believe, blah, blah, blah. But if it gets to a certain point, you're talking about a child in there. I mean, that's a child. I have two children. I've seen, you know, ultrasounds. I've seen all that. It's a child. Everything's connected. His heart's beating.
So they should take the religious aspect out of it and say scientifically.
His heart's beating.
That's what I'm saying. But say scientifically, at this point, whatever week that is,
this person has rights. It's fairly early.
And that's what they should go with then, I guess, this person has rights at this point.
It's fairly early. That's the problem.
And maybe that's when the government, okay.
I think it's around 10 to 12 weeks is a lot of places are earlier than that. And I don't think that's fair because you don't, like I said, you don't think you find out.
I keep hearing like 16 to 17 weeks is that number that they're...
To me, that's a little higher than I would like because I still think that there's life at that point that's connected and all that stuff. And if you took an ultrasound, you'd see a baby. And again, maybe you have to be a parent. I don't know. I've seen ultrasounds and I'm like, look, there's his head, there's his arms, there's her or his whatever. And to me, when it gets to that point, it's like, look, just have it. And there are plenty of people that can't have children that want that child. Mm-hmm. So what's the point of aborting at that point? Like if you get to, if it's 9 weeks in and it's still kind of like nothing's happened. Okay. I don't love it, but it's your choice. Mm-hmm. It's your body. But once it becomes a child, I think it's not just your body anymore. And that's what women hate. I'm going to get about her comments going to come from this. Women hate to hear this, especially from men. But you know what? Men have something to do with what's in there too. Mm-hmm. And it's not our fault that biologically we're not the ones giving birth. It's not our fault. It's just the way it is.
Yeah.
And I just think that if I impregnated, if I wasn't married to my beautiful wife and I had two children, if I impregnated, which could be out there somewhere, who knows, and I knew about it, that I would be able to have a say in it. Just because it's not in my body, that's not my fault.
Yeah.
Right? You don't have to agree with me. I am not all about this whole, you know, against my woman and my body thing. I get it. I understand. It's your body. You don't like being told what to do. I get it. I'm not trying to tell you what to do. I'm just telling you to think about it and make a decision when it's responsible and not when the baby's already formed.
Fair enough. Yeah.
Okay. How'd that discussion go?
Yeah.
I don't think it really, because I'm not really voting on abortion. I think that's a huge topic for Kamala Harris.
Right.
Those guys over there on the left are really running on that. They're like, look, do whatever
you want. That hits home to a lot of people, you know?
It hits home to a lot of women who are just like, I mean, look, I had a very, very, very fast story. We got to get going here. I think this is good stuff, and that's why I'm letting us roll. Although after your story tonight, if you've listened to the whole show, apparently you can have a child at 76. But there's like this 70 or 80-year-old woman who's like, leave, you can't tell me what the fuck to do with my body. And I'm like, you're not involved in this conversation because you're not a part of that. And there's just this idea that that somebody could possibly tell you what to do with your own body is what's causing so many people to turn away from Donald Trump and go to Kamala Harris. Mm-hmm. And I just feel like...
But like you said, it all depends on what issues are important to you, right? So...
There you go. And I was going to say that at the end, but I'll say it now. What this election needs to be about, people, if you've hung in there this long with this incredible debate that we're having, is look at yourself, look at your life, look at your family, and prioritize what the most important things that a federal government should be in charge of. Mm-hmm. And prioritize those things and then make a decision based on that. Don't make a decision based on personality. Who gives a shit? Don't make a decision based on what you've heard and all these, you know, am I racist, Trey?
I don't think so.
Probably not. I don't think so. I like black guys. Look, I had a great conversation a group of lovely black women the other day, and they were amazing, and I loved them, and they loved me. I love it. The point is, if I vote for Donald Trump, I'm being called these things. I'm being called racist. I'm being called sexist. I'm being called this. I'm being called that, when none of those things have been proven to be true, on even on his behalf. And that's very... disturbing, and I talked about that in my video on top of the mountain. People go watch it. It's 15 minutes. It's half a sitcom, and we'll go from there. But let's move on. I still haven't figured out where you're gonna go, where you're gonna vote yet. Let's move on.
All right.
Really fast. Really fast. Immigration border. Let's do it.
Bad.
Immigration border. It's simple.
Tighten it up.
You agree?
I think so, yeah. We have to, right? I mean...
Of course.
If we have undocumented people coming into our United States, how do we keep them from just fucking shit up?
There's no way to monitor. There's no way to vet. There's no way to do any of that, right?
Has either of the candidates gone down to the border cities just to get their... ideas.
Well, Kamala was supposed to be there the last three. What I've heard is that Kamala is supposed to. The whole thing was that she was the border czar and she was supposed to be there. The people say she wasn't technically that title, but it doesn't matter. She was put in charge of the border. The only time she went there was one time to El Paso, which is like not really a crossing area. Mm-hmm. And the border patrol has officially endorsed Donald Trump.
Okay.
Saying that Kamala has done jack shit. Mm. I'm not just saying this. I'm telling you what this is truth. Go look it up, people. And my prop, this is the big Donald Trump. That's why you hear it. That's why you heard Donald and J.D. Vance after when we did our post-vice presidential debate. J.D. Vance, every question. God, the illegals are in here.
Yeah.
Because they didn't do anything. And there are like 15 million illegals. I think it's even higher now.
So what is the conspiracy theory as far as why they're allowing so many people to get through?
They don't have the capability to stop them.
Gotcha. Okay, so it's manpower, basically.
It's manpower, and it's if you find them, what happens? Nothing.
So I guess that's why I don't understand the reasoning why nothing happens.
But that's the problem, is no one understands why.
So they don't come out and say, here's the reason, here we're doing it because of this humane reason or whatever.
Right, no.
So no, well, none
what,
of that.
What they're saying is that these are people too and they deserve whatever. But, sure, of course, but so do the people that are doing it the right way. Mm-hmm. Applying, waiting, taking their time. And Tim Walz and Kamala are saying, Tim Walz in the state of Minnesota, he's the governor. He's trying to get them to be able to have like IDs just like that. Here's an ID.
So what does that do?
Which allows them to vote, by the way.
Right. So why does that help? I mean,
it doesn't. Sorry.
Okay.
I'm trying. That was one of my cards. I'll be quiet. I'm supposed to be neutral in this debate.
Well, right? And I just want to understand both sides. It's like they have a reason behind it, I'm sure. But what is that reason? That's what I've never heard.
Do you want my opinion? Can I use one of my cards on this topic? My opinion is that, honestly, these people, if they're led into this country, are going to vote for them. I know people think that's a conspiracy, but it's not. They come in and they're like, well, who's letting me stay here? Kamala and Tim Walz.
But that's only for 4 years, and then Kamala's gone.
Well, but that's...
And then we still have an issue.
That's enough for them to kind of blend in.
Right.
And that's the problem. And there are 27, something like that, states that do not require a proof of citizenship to get an ID.
That makes no sense to me at all.
I agree. Tim Walz has come out and flat out said, Minnesota, we're going to try and get the illegal immigrants, the refugees. They're trying to escape hostility. And they're going to give them IDs. Okay? And so that's a problem. Because now they can go vote and they don't have to prove anything. Okay? Well, most people that are not on their side believe that the reason for that is so they can get votes.
Gotcha.
But we talked about the hurricane victims. These people that come in illegally are getting free housing, free handouts, IDs, all these things that money could go towards for our citizens. People want to be here, and I love that. I respect that. We're the greatest country in the world. We were. I still believe that we can be and that we are. There's a reason that there was a line, hundreds of, probably a millions long, to get into this country legally, because we are the best. But all of a sudden, people are literally just coming across and getting free housing and getting all these things. And it's frustrating for me. So that's why I'm chiming in a little bit harder on this topic.
Yeah.
And that's why Tim Wall, J.D. Vance with his beautiful blue eyes and Donald have hit this topic so hard, because it is important. It does spread out like a spider web into other issues.
Yeah.
Not every issue. We didn't get to education, but you know, things like that. Okay. All right, fine. But that's an issue. So that's my thought. And that's why it's one of the big reasons I'm on Donald Trump's side, is because you cannot have a strong country without a strong border. And that's been proven in all of history. What do you think?
That makes sense.
You can disagree.
No, I mean,
this is a debate, Trey.
No, I feel like, yeah, we do have to get stronger borders.
Talk some shit.
Now, just curious. I guess I would love to understand the reason behind, you know, hopefully the conspiracy theories aren't true, but it's just like wondering what the need is to allow them in so easily, as opposed to, you know, making them jump through a few hoops, you know. So,
and that's what they should be doing, and what the idea was, is that, okay, you need to fill this out, do this, do that, and then eventually you get here, you'll get permitted to be here for a certain amount of time, and then you'll have to take your citizenship if you want it, and then it's like a progression.
Right.
And I have friends that have done it.
Mm-hmm.
I think Alina, our Russian guest, did that. But I know there's a gentleman from Bulgaria that I knew very well. And he's a huge Trump supporter, because he's pissed that all these people are coming in here. And he waited. And he went through landmines and communist Bulgaria trying to get into Greece. And they threw him back to Bulgaria. And he was in prisons. And
how come he hasn't been on the show yet?
Because he's in Maine. I need to find him.
Yeah.
He's fascinating. His story is fascinating. And I'd play golf with him. And he'd sit there and he'd tell me about it. And he's like, I just don't understand why anybody would vote opposing. This is a couple of years, you know, up in Maine. A couple of years ago. Why anybody would oppose this? Because this is a serious deal.
Yeah.
And so anyway, so that's what I think about that. And that's why I chimed in hard on that, because the border is an issue. And anybody that's watched the debates knows that the Trump camp is pushing that.
Yeah.
And I don't blame them. So lastly, we've gone way over, and I don't care. Our producers can, they'll deal with it because this is good. This is what we need to do, right?
Right.
And then you can go home and go to sleep. Really fast. Foreign affairs. You said you don't know shit about this. My point is simple. We've talked about it. How about not bending over for other countries, for NATO, for Ukraine, for Israel, for all these countries? The reason that our, we talked about it, the reason our hurricane victims are suffering is because FEMA didn't have any money in their account. Why? You and I cannot have any money in our account. That's different. But FEMA needs to have money in the account. Mm-hmm. If you're giving hundreds of billions to another country and FEMA doesn't have the $20 billion that's supposed to be in there, that's a problem. We talked about it. So foreign affairs is a big thing for me. Donald Trump isn't going to take shit. He's not. He's making NATO, and I had this on my other notes, but we're already way over. So Donald Trump wants to make NATO and the members of NATO pay 2% whatever for their own self-defense. Because right now, guess what? We're paying.
So we pay for everybody's self-defense.
Absolutely. Or more, way more. So he's just asking for 2% and they can, and they'll be defended because it's a big club and everybody takes care of each other.
So are we the bouncer for everybody?
Pretty much. But that's the way it always was. People forget that. That's the way it's been. That's why we were World War II. We took, when we entered it, it was done. We are, it's like if you have funding from us and you have our support, you kick ass. And I'm saying this in a totally dumbed down way so that everybody understands. You cannot, if you're NATO, if you're these groups, foreign European countries and other countries, expect us to sit here and foot the bill. Donald is a business guy and he's not going to foot the bill. And so all I'm doing is taking these topics and telling you why. It turned into less of a debate, more of me telling you why Donald Trump's going to do better. But it's still a debate because we look sharp with our ties.
Yeah.
But you cannot give this much money to Ukraine. You just can't. I mean, we have people, you have to apply for $750. You're sitting on your rooftop about to fall in.
Well, I guess I'm curious how they got to the billions too, you know? So
look, Zelensky's been caught on tape with in his villas and his cars.
I mean, millions is still a lot of money, no?
Well, I thought so, but he's in the hundreds of billions, not just
that's what I'm billion, saying.
Hundreds of billions. And they just signed another one the other day for 10 more billion or something crazy. And that's why Putin's like, really? Like, okay. And he doesn't want Trump in. He's fine with them doing this because they're so, everybody takes advantage of the current administration. No one, Biden?
Well, I can't imagine.
Biden's our president. He's done, what has he been doing?
So what does it benefit the current administration to keep the war going? So that's, I guess, I hear as soon as Trump is elected, he'll shut it down. Well, what is it that the current administration is not doing to shut it down? Because I can't imagine why they're wanting to still throw more money.
We talked a little bit about it, and I think that there's this idea that the war distracts from the reality of the situation that's happening here. I think that there's a way that they're in bed with these countries like Ukraine, and Ukraine will, they'll help each other out, if you will.
What is Ukraine going to do to help us out?
I don't know.
That's what I, but that's I don't what know. I understand.
I'm not there. I'm not part of it. So I don't know.
So all this is basically a bunch of
conspiracy
theories, right?
Why do these presidents and politicians leave office, millionaires and billionaires.
Right, right.
And they go in not worth shit. That's my problem. And that's why, and that's what we'll end, because we have to. You need to sleep. We'll end here. Politicians go in worth nothing. Mm-hmm. And they come out worth a shitload of money. The only politician, I think I've said this before, that hasn't is Donald Trump.
Donald Trump, yeah.
He goes in and he comes out worth less. He didn't take a salary. He actually put a lot of his profits from his foreign hotels into the U.S. Treasury, which people don't know.
I didn't know that, no.
Yeah. And he doesn't need to be in bed with anybody. He doesn't need Ukraine. He doesn't need Israel. He's going to do what's best. He has diplomatic relations with countries like Russia, who all of a sudden everybody's like, how dare we talk about Putin? Look, just because he has, we've talked about this a lot, just because he has diplomatic relations and he talks to Putin on a level that's not like spitting at him. What's the cliche? Keep your enemies, your friends close, your enemies closer.
Closer, yeah.
That's the point. He's the only president, like our Russian friend, Alina, said, that went over to talk to Kim Jong-un. And
Rodman did it too.
Look, President Rodman, I'm all for it. Rodman Trump. But the point is that if you have diplomatic relations where you can talk to somebody, you're going to prevent escalated potential war, an escalated potential conflict that can go crazy.
So what's keeping that current administration from getting that diplomatic relationship?
Because they view them as the enemy. And this is my opinion. Mm-hmm. They view them as the enemy. And they think that if they go, honestly, I'm not going to lie to you, I think Putin is saying, fuck you, to Kamala Harris and Joe Biden. I think Kim Jong-un's like, who are these idiots? And I think that Donald Trump has something about him that is a leader. And he wants to go in and he's going to treat them with respect. And people here have a problem. This is brilliant. I need to make this a clip. People have a problem with treating other leaders that have different ways of life and different policies than we do here. Communism in both countries. The way North Korea has issues, in our opinion. But to go over there and still show them respect as leaders. This is your country. You do you. Putin, you do you. Kim Jong-un, you do you. We're going to do us. Mm-hmm. And let's get along somehow, some way. There's a level of respect there that I don't think that Kamala or Joe Biden or any of those guys were willing to do. Because they're like, who are we? And I think Donald Trump understands it's kind of like a business deal. And that's who he is. That's why I think that Donald Trump best for being the leader of this country. Lots of leaders were hated. Generals hated. I've said it before. Donald Trump, a lot of people hate him, but doesn't mean he's not going to be effective for what we need when it comes to the last topic, which was foreign affairs.
Yeah.
So what do you think? We've gone so long. I don't give a shit. I promised you an hour. It's not an hour. But this debate needed to happen.
Yeah, I may have to actually listen to this show.
You know, listen to learn and make your decision.
Right.
It's 2 weeks away. You don't have to tell me who.
Is it really?
It's 2 weeks away. Are you registered? Did you register?
I can neither confirm nor deny that.
Jesus Christ. I don't even know if there's a limit. I don't even know if you can still. If you don't have to tell me who, but did the discussion help you kind of go, all right, I'm more aligned with this side versus this side. Don't tell me who. You don't feel pressured by who I like.
I think it was a good discussion, yes. I guess there's still some questions as far as reasoning behind certain decisions.
You're still taking it. You're still going to go.
It's both sides.
Dig deeper.
Yeah. Okay.
What do we need to do to get you to the finish line? Either side, Kamala or Donald Trump.
I need a personal phone call. Have a discussion. Say, Trey, here's how my policies are going to benefit you.
All right.
And maybe that's why I don't know who would work best, is because also I'm thinking policies are important, right? Which policies are going to help little old me, you know? And I think that's the hard decision, is because these policies are so far up here, big picture, and I'm down here. So really, how's that trickle-down effect really going to affect me in the right. grand scheme of things? So,
and that's how we'll end. because that's exactly it. It needs to be, every person needs to look in the mirror and say, what are my priorities? I think I said this earlier. Prioritize what's important to you, your family, from a federal government, and then make a decision not based on mean tweets, not based on a cackling laugh, not based on either candidate's personalities. Mm-hmm. Yes, you have to look a little bit at their ability to answer questions, mm-hmm. and all that. But bottom line is, what policies are most important? Is abortion most important to somebody?
Right.
Well, it's not to me because it's not going to affect me.
Yeah.
Maybe it is to a 27-year-old girl who likes to bang. I mean, I don't mean to be crude, but that's the truth. Mm-hmm. Is foreign policy important to be? Yeah. Figure out what's important to you and prioritize it, and then kind of figure out which side is best
right
for you. I'm sitting here. I've got a screen of all these little details. Man, can you imagine if we got into that? 60% corporate tax raises. We didn't even get into like tips, no taxes on tips, no taxes on. Mm-hmm. I thought these were the six most important topics. Do you agree?
I think so.
And so we'll end, and we went very long, but I think it was good. And I'm going to make them do this as a one part. We're not splitting this shit up. One part episode. Listen to this. Hopefully people like us who aren't scholars in political science.
Yeah.
Which is, again, 90% of the, 90 more than that probably, of the world, are people like us that are sitting here just having a conversation, trying to figure it all out. And don't listen to those crazy political science guys. They're going to confuse you. Listen to guys like us. Listen to guys like us. Who really are just kind of saying, hey, look, here's the big picture.
Right.
Do you agree or disagree?
Do you have a political quote you can end with?
I don't, but I have.
Don't do a love one.
I have funny or I have serious. You want a funny?
Of course I need funny after this.
Well, all these are about love.
Oh, okay. Look into my eyes when you say this.
This is so stupid.
It's about love?
But it makes sense. I mean, like, look. All right. Love you guys. Hope you guys enjoy the debate, discussion. Trey and I worked really hard on anything?
Planning it. The ties?
There you go, the ties. Yeah. What do you think? I like your gray and white, my black and purple. These should be the new colors of the parties.
I went with gray because stay in the gray.
I only had one gray tie. Anyway, how about this, Trey? If you were happy every day of your life, you wouldn't be a human being. You'd be a game show host.
That was not about love at all.
Tell me that game show hosts don't have...
They're always happy.
Every day.
They are always happy.
What game show host is like, here we are again, fucking yeah. Wheel of Fortune, sucks my balls.
Spin the wheel, you dick.
Spin the wheel, you ass. Bob Barker, all those guys had a blast.
Yeah.
So, look, they're not human, apparently.
At all.
I don't know about that quote, but it felt works. Fitting tonight. So, everybody, like and subscribe and follow and comment. I'm happy to be back. I took a little breather. I needed it. And nothing like sitting here with Trey and doing this show. So any social media, anything, everything works. Tell everybody, blah, 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 blah.
And like, subscribe.
Like and subscribe. Elections in 2 weeks. We've got some great stuff coming up. If anybody remembers Liv, our Australian... a young lady who had all sorts of issues growing up in a cult, dating, drugs, addiction, all kinds of stuff. She's going to come back and she's going to shock you a little more because from what I understand, it's
never a dull moment.
Never a dull moment with Liv. So she'll be back soon. Hope you've enjoyed everything, and we'll see you next time.
Sounds good.
Sounds good. All right, man. Sorry it was so late. But
no, you're not.
This election is very important. We needed this to happen.
Yeah.
All right. Love you guys.
Later.
Roll it out, boys. Music. I accidentally hit two buttons at once. See you later, everybody. Love you.
Bye.